Will you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the completion of another academic year and for giving us the opportunity in the midst of unprecedented times to play a part in the lives of our students and our graduates. We are grateful for your guidance and love as we shared in this important work. We ask that you would please bless and guide our graduates as they reach this milestone and as they continue to begin new endeavors. May what they have learned by being here with us allow them to truly be servant leaders who know God. May what we have learned from them as well enable us to be the same. Lord, please help them to use all that they have learned here to follow Jesus, be changed by Jesus, and be committed to the mission of Jesus in reconciling the world back to you. I pray that they would stand in the gap as a royal priesthood, reconciling and having the same mind that was in Christ Jesus. Lord, we know that some of them will experience pain and hardship, and we know that many of them already have, and we ask that you would grant them comfort and strength. Finally, Father, we thank you for giving us the opportunity to build our community with these young men and women while they were here. Though they are leaving our campus, we know that they will always be with us as part of KCC, and we ask that the bonds that have been created here remain strong despite distance and calling. We ask all of this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Welcome to the 2020 KCC and OCS commencement exercises. This day comes during an unprecedented time in the history of this institution and in the history of our country. When this school year began, none of us thought that we would be holding a virtual commencement. But in the face of COVID-19, we have had to adapt. While the format is different this year, and people are tuning in from around the country, even around the world, this day marks the completion of years of educational preparation for our graduates. Their hard work and diligence will soon be rewarded by the coveted diploma, which opens new doors and new opportunities for each one of them. And we congratulate each one of you who have reached this milestone. We also want to recognize their families who have stood with them, who have helped them on their homework and supported them financially and prayed for them every step of the way. Parents, siblings, grandparents, and other family members. We honor you and we recognize you this morning for your faithful support of your graduate through the years. Commencement also provides an opportunity to recognize our outstanding faculty and staff who are dedicated to providing the best in Christian education. Our faculty and staff have had to make adjustments to how we operate in an effort to have a strong finish to this school year, to this semester. Our teachers successfully implemented virtual learning from our K-12 department all the way through the college, and they did that in just over a week. And I can't say enough of how proud I am of our teachers. And this morning, we also want to honor them and recognize them for their sacrificial work. For the past 82 years, we have been about the business of preparing young men and women to be equipped for serving in God's kingdom. But if we have merely educated our students with book knowledge, then we have fallen short. Our mission at KCC is to develop servant leaders who know God and who have a passion for holiness of heart and who are inspired and prepared for a lifetime of learning and kingdom service. As it has in the past, this call to service will make a difference around the world as our graduates take their place in occupations of influence and responsibility and leadership, shining the light of Jesus wherever they may go. For some, this will be in full-time ministry. For others, this will be service, faithful service in the marketplace. But 2020 graduates, now is your time to discover the amazing opportunities that await you in your service to God and to impact a lost world for Jesus Christ. We have confidence that you will do that with class. Our prayer is that you will walk with God and be guided by biblical truth every day of your life. And may God bless each one of you. Now, we are honored this morning to have as our commencement speaker, Dr. Brent Hewlett. Dr. Hewlett currently is a global missions director for the Church of the Nazarene denomination and is responsible for recruiting, assessing, and mobilizing all new missionaries who come from 67 countries and work in 163 world areas. He and his wife, Darla, are the proud parents of two adult sons, and they have been married for 31 years. They both grew up in Missouri and accepted Christ very early as children and have served Jesus all of their lives. They have held pastorates in Missouri and Washington and Kansas, and they were missionaries in the Philippines. Dr. Hewlett has traveled and ministered in 41 countries while coordinating theological education and administering missionaries with multiple missions agencies. Dr. Brent and Darla Hewlett have long been friends of my family, and for as long as I can remember, they have been friends and supporters of Kansas Christian College and Overland Christian Schools. In fact, they are both alums of our school, and we are proud of how God has used them to change the world for Jesus Christ. Dr. Hewlett received a Bachelor of Arts in Religion degree from Kansas Christian College, then known as Kansas City College and Bible School. He also went on to receive a Master's of Divinity in Missiology and a Doctorate of Ministry in Pastoral Theology, both of those at Nazarene Theological Seminary. Since 2019, he and his wife have lived in Olathe, Kansas, and it is my privilege this morning to welcome Dr. Brent Hewlett back to Kansas Christian College as our commencement speaker. Dr. Hewlett.
Thank you, President Pollard, distinguished professors, honored guests, and 2020 graduates of Kansas Christian College and Overland Christian School. It is my distinct pleasure and honor to come back to my alma mater and participate in such a significant event in your lives. Thank you for this privilege. I've attended many graduation ceremonies as student, professor, administrator, and I found that the commencement address is normally early on in the schedule. Can I tell you why that is? I'll let you in on the secret. It's what Mark Twain called the live frog principle. He advised people that they should swallow a live frog early in the day. That way they will know that the worst part of their day was behind them. With that in mind, I want to spend a few minutes sharing with you some profound wisdom and life-changing inspiration that in 10 years from now, only your mother will remember. Back in the spring of 1985, I received a letter from the registrar of what was then called Kansas City College and Bible School, informing me that I had been accepted as a student and was invited to begin my academic matriculation in the fall. I was honored. Since I had graduated in the top 10% of the bottom half of my high school class. Not really, but I was a straight B student with braces who was known for having mad skills playing the snare drum in the marching band, which come to find out is not necessarily a real life skill necessary. So off to college I went thinking that I had really pulled the wool over the eyes of the new student acceptance committee. I confess that my 18-year-old world was black or white, rarely was it gray. It was either good or bad, yes or no, either this way or that way. There weren't very many questions in my mind that did not have a definite answer. So I came to my places of education, undergraduate, graduate, doctoral studies, expecting that the great questions of life would be explained to me. I expected that once I finished all of my education, that I would know, I would be correct, I would be prepared with every answer that was necessary for successful ministry and a godly life. And I assume that in many ways, that is where you find yourself. You have successfully matriculated through an academic program. You've spent way too many late nights living on caffeine and potato chips to pass that one last final. You've memorized, wrestled with, and applied information that has rocked your world, and in many ways, you are prepared. So I stepped into ministry as a pastor, later as a missionary, and then an education administrator. But what I found waiting was not as cut and dried as I expected. Early in my missionary career, I had the privilege of teaching theological education and leadership in several countries in Asia and the South Pacific. I was invited to go to Cambodia to teach. It was a small third world country in East Asia, bordered by Vietnam and Thailand. Just 15 years before, a small rebel group called the Khmer Rouge had devastated the country. In a country with the population size of Missouri, they killed over 1.7 million people through work camps, starvation, and torture. And during one of the breaks in the lectures, they walked me through what was then called the killing fields of Phnom Penh, full of very, very shallow graves. I went back into the sanctuary that doubled as the lecture hall and realized that every student present probably had a father or a brother or a sister that had been killed. How would I teach the truths of grace, mercy, and forgiveness through the lenses of their experience? How did my education prepare me for how I would teach theology in the context of personal devastation? Years later, I was in the highlands of Papua New Guinea celebrating the dedication of a new language translation of the Bible. For modesty, the people wore a very, very few vines around their waist and lived in smoke-filled huts miles from civilization. Just decades before, they literally had been cannibals, reenacting for us how and where they had taken the lives of the missionaries. Was there a lecture from my education that I could lean on to tell me exactly how to teach and preach to them? Need I bring up the elephant in the room today? Here we are. We find ourselves in a shelter-in-place context, having commencement in a way that we never would have guessed 6 months ago. It seems that the whole world's security and economy has been affected by this unseen virus. How will you lead and teach and live in the post-COVID context where everyone has been affected? I came to realize that what my professors and mentors meant to leave with me was not the answer to every situation. There was no way they could have taught me every answer on how to live in a world with changing technology, surprising political movements, or astonishing moral degradation. No, their desire was not to give me every answer. Their commitment was to teach me to ask the right questions. You remember I told you that I'd been a straight B student in high school. Well, I can tell you that not much has changed. I continue through all of my studies being a pretty average student. Now, I can tell you that later in life, I did develop some mad skills playing the congas, and we all know how necessary of a skill that is in real life. Seriously, as I stepped into my places of ministry and leadership, I thought often about how average I was intellectually. I was afraid other leaders might find out how utterly normal I was. But I then became comfortable with the fact that I never would be the smartest person in the room. And my goal became seeking to become the one in the room who asked the right questions so that the most effective and genuine answer could be discovered. Leadership consultant Bob Beal often says, if you ask profound questions, you receive profound answers. If you ask shallow questions, you receive shallow answers. And if you ask no questions, you receive no answers. I realized that if the world was going to continue to evolve, and if I was going to continue to be utterly average, I was going to have to learn to ask the right questions. Can I tell you what some of the most effective questions ever asked of me have been? my father-in-law, one of my heroes, asked me this question one day. Are you personally experiencing all that the cross has provided for you? You know why he asked that of me? Because that question had so transformed his theology that he wanted it to transform mine. So he gave me a gift by asking me that same transformational question. It caused me to think through the scriptures, to compare what God had promised me with what I currently was living and practicing. Was I living in the power that was promised by the Spirit of God? Was I enjoying the forgiveness that was purchased for me by the crucified Christ? Was I experiencing the personal presence of walking with God daily? Here's another question that radically changed my perspective. Can you tell me more? I remember a time when I was a poor graduate student. I was asked to go pick up one of my theological heroes at the airport for a conference where he was to speak. Here I was in my beat-up old 1978 brown Buick four-door sedan picking up an author of about 40 books. I had so many questions for him. As we drove to his hotel, I knew that I would have around 45 minutes all to myself, and I could ask him anything. But you know what he wanted to talk about? Me. He wanted to ask me questions. He asked about my life and my family and my studies and my ministry the entire trip. And you know what that question meant to me? Can you tell me more? It meant that to him, I was important. I mattered. I was valued. My opinion was of great worth. Bring value to others by inviting them to tell you more. Can you tell me more about your life? Can you tell me more about why you believe that? Can you tell me more about your perspective? There's another that in almost any discussion becomes the question that delivers the most sharply focused answer. It tightens the screws. It clears the cloudiness. It narrows the lens. And don't laugh at me when I tell you what it is, because it is so simple. It's the question, why? Why is that so important to you? Why do you feel that way? Why do you believe that to be true? You don't need me to give you a lecture on the use of questions, so we all know that there are two functions of a question. The first is to evaluate knowledge. That's useful and certainly needed in many contexts. There are times that we need to hear a piece of information that can only be obtained when we ask somebody why. But it is the second function of a question that makes this why question so powerful. When you place a match and gasoline together, nothing of importance happens. But when friction is caused on that match and fire is produced, all of a sudden, the inert fluid called gasoline explodes with power. So is the second function of the question, why? So if the first function of the question is to evaluate knowledge, the second is to cause thinking. My goal is not to always be the one with the knowledge, but it is to be the one who causes people to think and process, to evaluate, to calculate, to assess. God is pretty good at asking questions too. In fact, I would dare say that almost every primary character in the Old Testament, God asked a significant question to. A question that radically changed his or her perspective. And when God asked questions of them, it wasn't that he needed to obtain knowledge from them. No, it was because he knew that a question was the best way for them to obtain a new revelation about themselves or a new understanding of himself. for Adam and Eve, God asked, "Where are you?" It wasn't that he didn't know where they were, but he was asking, "Where is my intimacy with you?" God loves us so much that he creates opportunities for us to recognize our tendency to distance ourselves from God when we sin. And he asks us, "Where are you? What happened to our relationship? Won't you come back?" For Moses, God asked, "What's in your hands?" And when Moses looked down, he only found a tool of shepherding, a basic weapon against snakes, a necessary leaning pole for an old man, but nonetheless, it was just a well-worn stick. But through this divine question, he expanded Moses' understanding of what God could do with whatever we have at his disposal if we dedicate it to God. Jesus asked powerful questions as well. In fact, depending on how you count them, he asked around 250 questions in the New Testament. But he only answered three of them. Why? Because he understood the power of the question. As a good rabbi, Jesus was expected to ask questions in response to questions. He knew that questions would force his students to expand their conversations, search for new ideas, and examine new vistas. He taught us that the great issues of the day are so important that they are worth more than one perspective or a singular answer. You see, hard issues deserve considered questions. I'm confident that your professors and mentors taught you by example that the great issues of the day and the challenging questions of your future cannot be solved by a simple answer. A lecture, no matter how profound, will come short to fully prepare you for everything that is to come. Your future will be full of changing contexts, new and amazing technology, evolving moral enigmas, and innovative opportunities. I encourage you, then, to develop an inquisitive mind. Don't settle for shallow answers to thick questions. Be hungry for understanding by seeking new perspectives. Expensive questions will always purchase valuable answers. So, graduates, I'm very happy for you and excited about how you will respond to an ever-evolving and changing future. Your inquisitive mind and drive for a fresh perspective could set the world on fire seeking truth in Jesus. So tell me, how do you think you can accomplish that? May the Lord bless you.
Overland Christian School graduates with a cumulative grade point average of 3.9 and above become members of the Honorary Scholastic Torchlight Society and have conferred upon them the distinction of graduating with highest honors. Honor students will have their names added to a plaque that is displayed in the OCS hallway. Let's congratulate Rayanne Moss for graduating with highest honors. Piper Berquist is graduating with a cumulative GPA that qualifies her as the salutatorian of the 2020 graduating class. We congratulate her, the OCS 2020 salutatorian. Rayanne Moss is graduating with a cumulative GPA that qualifies her as the valedictorian of the 2020 graduating class and, as mentioned before, a a member of the Honorary Scholastic Torchlight Society for graduating with highest honors. We congratulate Rayanne as the OCS 2020 valedictorian.
In 1971, KCC began a new tradition, the Student of the Year Award. The college student body and faculty vote to select this student. The student must have a cumulative grade point average of at least 3.0, must be outstanding in achievements of offices held, as demonstrated in school and social life, and must be distinguished in Christian character. The student selected to be the year 2020 Student of the Year, the 48th recipient of this award, is Talis Rocio. Talis is unable to be with us today, having already returned home to Brazil, but we send him our congratulations. He will receive a Student of the Year trophy, and his name will be engraved on this perpetual trophy that's kept here at the college.
He came here to campus as a freshman in college in 1967, leaving his home in Lowry City, Missouri. It was while he was here that he met and fell in love with Donna Kramer. 2 years later, they were married on November 28, 1969. Delbert Scott went on to graduate with an education degree from Southwest Missouri State College. He taught school for 4 years, and he returned home to join the family hardware and home furnishings business, where he remained active until it closed less than a decade ago. Dr. Scott went into state politics in the 1980s. After serving 18 years in the Missouri House of Representatives, Senator Scott was elected to the Missouri Senate in 2002, where he served until reaching term limits in 2010. During his time in the Missouri legislature, he gained the respect of his peers on both sides of the aisle and was elected to leadership positions in both the House and the Senate. While serving in the legislature, Delbert received many awards and recognitions for his service to his constituents in Southwest Missouri and the state as a whole. He was also awarded an honorary doctorate degree in political science from Southwest Baptist University in Bolivar, Missouri. Just as he was preparing to retire from the Missouri legislature, he answered God's call to continuing service. Only this time, he would be serving the students, faculty, and staff on the campus of Kansas City College and Bible School. He began his tenure in November 2009 as the 11th president of this institution. When he stepped foot onto the campus, he was immediately met with challenges, including a total enrollment of about 60 students. Through the leadership of Dr. Scott, things began to turn around. Accreditation of the college began in 2008 under the leadership of then-president Dr. Gail Woods and academic dean Dorothy Pirtle. And during Dr. Scott's tenure, the college was awarded candidate status through the Association for Biblical Higher Education. In 2013, and then the accreditation process continued until the college received accreditation in February 2017. During his time at the helm, we received approval to distribute Title IV funds, which is the Pell Grants and loans, and we expanded academic program offerings on campus, and we ventured into the world of online education, now offering multiple degrees. We established academic partnerships with other colleges and universities. Overland Christian Schools expanded from 44 students to its peak of 150 in 2016. The college department began to grow through renewed recruiting efforts as well as the addition of an athletics program. In the college, enrollment climbed from less than 20 in the fall of 2009 to 170 during the 2018-19 academic year. We completed campus renovation projects and purchased multiple vehicles to accommodate transportation needs of the growing student body. In fact, under Dr. Scott's leadership, KCC moved farther down the path towards financial stability by establishing a budget and growing our endowment and reducing some of our debt. After nearly 10 years at the helm, Dr. Scott felt the Lord calling him to move on again to serve. Only this time, he was going into full-time service to his family. His wife, Donna, of 50 years, his three adult children and their families, Todd and Tim and Tiffany, and his grandchildren. And when he retired from public service and from service to Kansas Christian College, one thing I know about Dr. Delbert Scott is that he will never retire from serving others. He has a strong track record of service to others and to God's kingdom. In my first year here as president of Kansas Christian College, after serving by his side for 9 years, I couldn't think of a person more deserving of this award. For his many years of excellent service to this institution, we award Dr. Delbert Scott the 2020 Distinguished Service Award. And while he can't be here to accept the award and we can't honor him with a standing ovation, I hope that you will find some way to reach out to him and express your appreciation to him. Dr. Scott, we love you and we appreciate you. Thank you for your years of faithful service and for your impact on my life and on the lives of so many others.
The Association for Biblical Higher Education established the Delta Epsilon Chi Honor Society to encourage and recognize graduating seniors and alumni from among the institutions accredited by ABHE. Members of this organization have distinguished themselves by intellectual achievement, Christian character, and leadership ability. The three Greek words translated approved in Christ, dokimos in Christos, found in Romans 16:10, begin with the three Greek letters Delta Epsilon Chi, and thus the name and meaning of the ABHE Honor Society. The Kansas Christian College faculty has nominated both a graduating senior and an alumnus for membership in Delta Epsilon Chi. Our 2020 Scholastic inductee has exhibited Christian character, leadership ability, and has maintained a cumulative GPA of above 3.3 on a 4-point scale. We salute the 2020 Scholastic inductee to the Delta Epsilon Chi Honor Society, Guilherme de Lima Pereira. Our 2020 honorary inductee has exhibited outstanding intellectual achievement, Christian character, and leadership ability. She is a 2002 graduate of Kansas Christian College. She currently serves as the first and second grade teacher and early childhood director, assistant early childhood director at Overland Christian Schools. She also oversees education practica and supervises student teaching at KCC. Please welcome the 2020 honorary inductee to the Delta Epsilon Chi Honor Society, Mrs. Amy Askew.
Thank you to the faculty and staff of KCC. I appreciate the role that KCC and OCS have played in my life. My plan was to attend for my freshman year of college and then transfer, but that was 23 years ago and I'm still here. I am grateful for the role the school played in preparing me for what God had planned for my life and the ministries I have been able to be a part of. I enjoy the fact that now I get to work here and our children are able to attend OCS and be able to be a part of this family. Thank you very much.
Mr. President, it gives me great pleasure to present to you the 2020 graduating class of Overland Christian School. We pray for and anticipate God's mighty use of these graduates in His kingdom as they go from here to pursue His will for their lives. These students have successfully completed the course of study prescribed by the Board of Trustees, the OCS administration, and the state of Kansas, and have come this day as candidates to receive their high school diplomas.
By virtue of the authority vested in me by the Board of Trustees of Kansas Christian College and Overland Christian Schools, it gives me great pleasure to present each one of you your high school diploma.
Piper E. Bergquist. Young-suk Lee. Rayanne Moss. Landon Jesus Recinos. Lynn Tran. Yifan Wong.
Mr. President, it gives me great pleasure to present to you the candidates for the Associate of Arts degree of the Kansas Christian College graduating class of 2020. They have completed their course of study as prescribed by the college faculty and the Kansas Christian College Board of Trustees. I therefore recommend these candidates to you today as eligible for the college diploma.
By virtue of the authority vested in me by the Board of Trustees of Kansas Christian College, I do hereby confer upon you the degree of Associate of Arts with all the rights, privileges, and responsibilities thereto appertaining. Congratulations.
Demia Alexandria Covington, Associate of Arts in General Studies. Quanisha Davis, Associate of Arts in General Studies. Coriana Ali Forshi, Associate of Arts in Business Leadership. Joshua Franco, Associate of Arts in General Studies. Monique D. Hunt, Associate of Arts in Business Leadership, Sport Management. Chalene Josafa, Associate of Arts in Business Leadership. Syed Ahmed Zia Mosavi, Associate of Arts in Business Leadership. E.J. Ransom, Associate of Arts in General Studies. Terrence Rhodes, Associate of Arts in Leadership and Ministry. Autumn L. Thamavangsa, Associate of Arts in Leadership and Ministry. Joshua L. Walker, Associate of Arts in Business Leadership, Sport Management. Mr. President, it gives me great pleasure to present to you the candidates for the Bachelor of Arts degree at Kansas Christian College in the graduating class of 2020. They have completed their course of study as prescribed by the college faculty and the Kansas Christian College Board of Trustees. I therefore recommend these candidates to you today as eligible for the college diploma.
By virtue of the authority vested in me by the Board of Trustees of Kansas Christian College, I do hereby confer upon you the degree of Bachelor of Arts with all the rights, privileges, and responsibilities thereto appertaining. Congratulations.
Guilherme de Lima Pereira, Bachelor of Arts in Business Leadership, Sport Management. Zacchaeus Faithon Dopin, Bachelor of Arts in Religion, Pastoral Ministry, as well as an Associate of Arts in Religion, Biblical Studies. Sarah Michelle Horn, Bachelor of Arts in Elementary Education. Jesse Ray Owens, Bachelor of Art in Religion, Pastoral Ministry, as well as an Associate of Arts in Religion, Biblical Studies. Joshua Isaac Plain, Bachelor of Arts in Business Leadership, Sport Management. Rochelle Elise Powers, Bachelor of Arts in Leadership and Ministry. Ja'Cory Washington, Bachelor of Arts in Business Leadership.
Want to congratulate all the graduates. Amen. Whoa, whoa.
Whoa,
whoa.
Whoa,
whoa.
Whoa,
whoa.
Whoa,
whoa.
Whoa.
Come on, sing that.
Whoa, whoa.
Holding me, I overcome by the blood of the Lamb.
I am victorious.
I can do all things, yes, I can.
I am triumphant.
Nothing is holding me.
I overcome by the blood.
Say, I am.
I am
a winner.
I am victorious.
I can do all things, yes, I can. Come on. Nothing is holding me. I overcome by the blood of the Lamb.
I am victorious.
I can do all things. Nothing is holding me.
I overcome by the blood of the Lamb.
I overcome by his blood. I was born a champion. I'm bold.
I'm strong.
I was born a champion.
Greater
is he that is within you.
I was born,
you were born a champion.
Champion.
You once were bound, but now you're free. Hey, I'm a champion. In your home, put your hands together. Come on. If you're next to a graduate, tell them that you are a winner. Say,
you are a winner.
You can do all things, yes you can.
You are triumphant.
Yes you can.
Nothing is holding you.
You overcome by the blood of the Lamb.
You are
yes you,
you
can.
Are victorious.
You can do all things, yes you can.
You are triumphant.
Nothing is holding you.
You overcome by the
listen.
Blood of the Lamb.
You overcome by his blood.
By his blood.
You were born.
You were born
a champion.
A champion.
You're bold.
You're bold.
You're strong.
You're strong.
You were born.
You were born
a champion.
The greater hey. That is in you.
You were born
a champion.
A champion.
You once were bound.
But now you're free.
Now you're free.
You're a champion. Champion.
Oh, you
all my champions, come on, clap your hands in your home. Come on. Listen, the Bible says that you are more than an overcomer. You're more than conquerors through him who loved you. So if you believe that, say to yourself these words. Come on, listen. A champion lives within me. He's given me authority. I'm bold. I'm strong. I overcome by the blood of the Lamb. Yes,
he's given me
authority.
I'm
bold,
I'm strong.
Yes, you overcome by the blood of the Lamb. A champion,
he's given me
authority.
I'm
bold,
I'm strong.
I overcome
by the blood of the Lamb.
A champion, he's given me
authority.
I'm bold.
I'm strong.
say.
You overcome by the blood.
Come on, put those hands together.
Oh, you overcome. Come by the blood of the Lamb.
God bless you.
Amen. Please join me as we close in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this opportunity to honor the graduates of the school year. Lord, we know that this didn't turn out the way that many of us were expecting, but God, we just pray that you would be especially with each graduate as they are moving on and finding exactly what you want for them and in the days to come. Lord, we see this this generation of graduates as those that are leading us into the future. And although right now the future might look a little uncertain, we know that you know exactly what we're headed into. We know that you hold the future. God, we just pray that you would help us to stay in step with you. Lord, help us to ask the right questions, especially of you and of what is impacting our future. Lord, we just thank you so much for everyone that's able to join us. And as we move on from here and into the summer and into the next few days, I just pray that you would bless each one and help us all to serve you with our whole heart, with all that we say and do. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.